No, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to be here, and I in particular like to thank Professor Lager for his patience and perseverance, and his team, Amy, putting this together. One of the big draws for me, I have to admit, as Austrian, was to having had the chance to do a long weekend, President's Week weekend of skiing with my son here. This is only one of the commonalities we have between Utah and Austria. You can ask me then any questions you want also in this respect. But I wanted to introduce the topic I wanted to talk about, Austrian foreign policy. I mean, hey, what is this? First of all, Austria is always confused with Australia. Where the heck is Austria? No, this is no joke. Even the UN, even my colleagues, they always get confused. And my Australian colleague and I were sitting next to each other in the UN. We're used to it. But what we did is we initiated a change in voting regulation at the UN. Before, you had to write in the country you're voting for a certain body, and we would always lose votes because they put Austria instead of Australia or vice versa. So now we have pre-printed ballot, so that it suffices to make an X and we don't lose votes. But that's the issue of confusing Austria and Australia. But why did I pick this title, What Foreign Policy for a Small Country? Because if you're talking about foreign policy, you talk about foreign policy of big nations, the US foreign policy, the Russian foreign policy, Chinese, but you don't talk about small countries. Do small countries have a foreign policy to begin with? Or do they just exist and swim with the masses of states here? And you are aware that we have about 200 states on this planet. 193 of them are full members of the United Nations. Two observer states, one of which is the state of Palestine, the other one is the Holy See, meaning the Vatican. So this is why what I chose this title, to provoke a little bit and say, okay, what is there? And I hope that at the end of my 20 minutes introduction, you would have a little bit more of an idea what a small country like Austria can do at all in foreign policy. The second aspect I want to mention in the introduction is foreign policy of every nation is influenced by both geography and history. It's not by chance that I studied these two subjects, majoring in, because it gives you a good basis of understanding of foreign policy in particular. It's not in a way that it's deterministic, but it has a huge influence, and I want to then explore with you a bit what is the case of Austria and how did it influence. If you try to picture Austria, Austria is a small landlocked country in the center of Europe. It is at the crossroads between East and West. And like with every European nation with thousands of years of history, which I don't want to bore you with, but just the most recent part of history, because this is the influential part of what this foreign policy of a small country ended up with. Austria used to be a big empire until the First World War, after the end, being on the loser side, it disintegrated into countries which were found by different peoples of the former empire. But that left Austria at that time with 6 million people as a little bit of a rump state with a totally oversized capital of 2 million people. So a third of the population lived in Vienna, a very imperial city. And a country where the people which were left over didn't know what to do with it, really. And it didn't really identify so much with this country. There were even two referenda of two of our nine provinces to become part of neighboring countries. Salzburg province wanted to become part of Germany, Vorarlberg province wanted to be part of Switzerland. So it was an unwanted state in 1918, and it only with time did people accept the fact that this is an independent country, which had a chance to live and have a meaning. Like many countries in the interwar period, with the Great Depression, Austria also had a short but a civil war and an undemocratic regime. Since 1934, we had an Austrofascism, which was more leaning towards Italian fascism of Mussolini, and was actually opposed to Nazism of Hitler in Germany. There was even a short putsch attempt by the Nazis in 1934, where the Chancellor of Austria, Dollfuss, was assassinated. And that is also a very unknown fact, that when 1938 happened, the Anschluss of Austria to Germany, to Hitler Germany, this was a preemptive military strike to avoid a referendum in Austria to stay independent. There was a majority in opinion polls clearly by that time saying, we are Austrians, we want to stay Austrian. With the Einmarsch, the influx of the Nazi troops, things reversed. But I always make this comparison to the annoyment of my Russian friends. Under the barrel of a gun, you can be certain how, what the outcome of a referendum is. So suddenly 99.5% of Austrians voted for the Anschluss. This is similar to the Crimea, where under the barrel of the gun, of course, they had the same outcome in 2014. Having said that, I also have to say that many Austrians were part and parcel of the horror regime of the Nazis. They were among the worst perpetrators you could find of the Nazi death machinery were Austrians, and there were many collaborators. And this is, I say this because this also has an influence on our foreign policy after the war. So we end up in 1945, and I know it's a little long, the historical, but then we come to the actual. In 1945, Austria had the same fate as Germany. It was, there were four powers, the French, the Brits, the Americans, and the Soviets, or the Russians, occupying parts of Austria. And Vienna, the capital, was also divided in four, like Berlin was. And everybody's aware of what happened in Berlin, but not that we had the very same situation in Austria. We were just lucky that we didn't have a permanent division of our country like Germany had, for a simple reason. The reason was that we in Austria were taking the historic opportunity after the death of Stalin, 1953, a bit of an opening of the Soviet Union, Western Germany having joined NATO, and then the only, that there was a wonderful price to give to the Soviet Union, to the Russians, our military neutrality, that we would put on ourselves the obligation not to join a military pact. As a Western-oriented country, that meant not to join NATO. And that was in the strategic interest of the Soviet Union, because it made, it built together with Switzerland a wedge into NATO countries between Germany in the north and Italy in the south. So through this, we were able to negotiate what was called a state treaty in 1955, where we regained our sovereignty and full independence. Because before, the Allied powers would have to rubber stamp or accept or correct any decision of the Austrian government. So we had an historic opportunity, and this was also where you have to find in diplomacy the moments where you you seize the moment, where you see the historic opportunity. Similar was with the German reunification. Had it been for the leadership of Helmut Kohl, the chancellor at that time, to go for reunification of East Germany with West Germany, and the way he did it, maybe somebody who was more hesitant, we would have had a different outcome. So that's the lesson one is seize the historic opportunity you have. And then, of course, this price, if you like, this political price of neutrality, this had a long-term effect on Austrian foreign policy. Not being a member of NATO, not being a member of any military pact, gave us a little bit of wiggle room in foreign policy. And in our case, it translates mostly in during the Cold War time, where the Iron Curtain was running east of Austria, so we were still on the western side. We made ourselves kind of a bridge, a go-between, a meeting point. Kennedy met Khrushchev in Salzburg. So that gave us the opportunity to also have a special area of our diplomacy. We would also be able to engage with Russia more, because they kind of trusted us more than, let's say, the Western Germans, who were solidly in one camp. We were able to find a niche, and this is another a big word for small countries, foreign diplomacy. You have to find your niche. Where can you be active? Where do you can you give an added value to international politics? And in the time of the Cold War, it was to serve as a bridge, to serve as a meeting point, and as I was joking also on Friday, it was also a meeting point until today of spies. Information exchange is not only in diplomacy, but also by intelligence services. But it was always that Austria was a neutral ground. And this neutral ground was also used to attract the UN. It was under former Chancellor Bruno Kreisky, who also had his very particular foreign policy, as an Austrian Jew, was the first one who reached out to Yasser Arafat from Palestine, and who was regarded at that time as a terrorist, and invited him to Vienna. And through this, he was able to put his part of, okay, you have to negotiate with Yasser Arafat. It's okay to talk to him, and only talking to him will you be able to bring peace to the Middle East. So there again, that was a little niche, which then helped that later on, you had the Oslo agreements, or the Madrid conference first, and then the Oslo agreements. Meeting point, neutrality we then used, especially in the field of being active in disarmament. Because we're not a member of a military a pact, we could easily be against certain categories of weapons, because they had no military value to us anyways, and we were not pushed by any of the big powers, east or west, to follow their line. We also used it to, as I started out to say, to attract the United Nations. Vienna is one of the three United Nations, now with Nairobi, four United Nations headquarters. The biggest, of course, in New York City, the second one in Geneva, the third one, which was opened in 1979, was in Vienna, and then later on now in Nairobi. So we're having 40 years of having the UN headquarters in Vienna, because we also wanted to really have a place of dialogue, of constructive interchange, because what you find very much in international politics is people don't talk to each other or talk past to each other. So what you really need is somehow create a venue where people talk to each other. Then also we are a seat of the OSCE, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, that was also a child of the Cold War, because it created a venue with the Helsinki Agreement of the two blocs, Eastern Bloc and Western Bloc talking to each other and discussing even touchy issues like human rights and civil liberties. And in the end of the day, many say that this organization, because it also dealt with human rights, had a role in the civil movements in the communist bloc to topple their governments. That was really 1989, the Annus Mirabilis, the year of wonders for us. You are, especially with the exception of some of the faculty, too young to remember, but the Iron Curtain was one of the worst dividing lines in civilization. Probably only comparable, I really got an eerie feeling when I went to the demilitarized zone between North Korea and South Korea. That was such an eerie experience. It's like we had the fences east of Austria. It was hardly penetrable. We hardly had any communication with our immediate neighbors who we were living with for centuries. So for us, with the fall of communism, opened up a totally new era. We suddenly got our neighborhood back, and we suddenly had the chance to engage with our neighborhood. One of the main features of international policy and foreign policy is everything starts with your neighborhood. Foreign policy, the biggest building block is with the neighborhood. If you can't arrange yourself with your neighbors, you will never live in peace and stability. And this is sometimes easier and sometimes more difficult, but one characteristic too, you have the most most intense relations with your neighbors. And the more relations you have with your neighbors, there can also be some irritants, as we say in our diplomatic jargons, with your neighbors, and especially historically charged ones. So this is the first challenge you have to overcome. And the opening, again, an historic opening, which came with the fall of the Iron Curtain, was that suddenly we were able to join the European Union. Before that, the Soviet Union would not allow us, because that would be some kind of giving up your sovereignty and independence, which was forbidden by the state treaty. So there again, we had a historic opportunity of a reformed Russia after the collapse of the Soviet Union, which gave us the space to enter the European Union. Why is that so important to a country like Austria? We're a small country, and we live of being an open economy and trading. I said already before that 6 out of 10 euros we earn comes from exports. So we're very highly open economy and diversified. And suddenly, the European Union gave us a market of today 500 million people, so not the 9 million people we're almost approaching. And through the European Union, of course, we get also the network of the European Union's free trade agreements with the entire globe. So that opened up a market for us even more. We're also an open economy for not only imports, but also investments. And we fared very well through that. And a lot has to do also with your foreign policy. There is one aspect of foreign policy which is economic diplomacy. Which is in times where we are part of the European Union limited, but if you're in a bilateral post, you also try to push your enterprises to be successful outside. Then, if we come to the United Nations, where I now work, and which I like to say is the pinnacle of all diplomatic work, because United Nations in New York is the only place where every nation of the world is represented, where every nation of the world can say what is their big issue. you would not necessarily think that, I don't know, let's take small island states in the Pacific, Palau and Austria, what do they have in common? In the UN, we find out that we do have something in common. This is the most fascinating thing for me to working at the UN. And why is the UN so important for Austria? Because as a small country, you need a rules-based system, rules-based international system. I tend to call it always the life insurance policy for small countries. If you don't have international law, it is the powerful countries which will dictate everything. I mean, to a large degree, they have a larger say as we small countries, but only through multilateralism, to a multilateral framework, can we pursue our interests better and actually preserve our independence and sovereignty. And so that's why Austria got engaged very quickly in the UN. We joined the same year we regained our sovereignty in 1955. We became UN member, despite being neutral. And why do I say that? Despite being neutral, because we interpret our neutrality is modeled after the Swiss neutrality. But Switzerland didn't become a full member of the United Nations until 2002. Why? Because they thought the United Nations would infringe on their sovereignty. Because if the Security Council decides something under Chapter 7, it is binding on every UN member state. So they said this is incompatible with our neutrality, and we defined it differently, saying no, this is not one big power imposing itself on us, but it is the international community through the UN which takes a collective decision. And yes, then, if need may be, of course, we are obliged to follow the decisions of the Security Council. We got very quickly engaged in trying to give back to the international community what we received. We were a country destroyed at the Second World War, and then from the 1960s on, we were doing economically fine. So and also we're thankful for those who liberated us in the First World War. Said okay, we should also help others, and we participated since 1960 in peacekeeping operations of the UN. We're a big peacekeeping nation. We're proud of that. We're a small country, small contributions, but we have about 1,000 to 1,100 soldiers and abroad in peace operations, not only by the UN but also by NATO led, but UN mandated, by the EU or the OSCE. So we try to have a very active role in supporting peace and stability abroad. From time to time, we also run for the Security Council. As you know, there is the chance to become an elected member for 2 years. We've been there three times in our history. We are a candidate again for the years 2027-28. So I'm already campaigning for that, not with you, but with the other member states, because they have to vote us in. You need a two-thirds majority of other member states to get in there. Where do you find us very active? I mentioned disarmament. There are different fields, more from the humanitarian side, where we were always part and parcel of the core group in conventions banning certain weapons which have indiscriminate effect. It started out with the landmines, then with the cluster munitions, because these two kinds of weapons have a very high toll on the civilian population. So with these two, we had two conventions, the Ottawa Convention, the Oslo Convention. Actually, the Ottawa Convention, the first draft was written by my colleagues in the Foreign Ministry. So there we have a very highly skilled and very engaged group of colleagues. And the newest, if you like, achievement, not everybody's happy with it, especially not the nuclear armed powers, is that 2 years ago we were able to agree on the treaty prohibiting nuclear weapons. that we said enough is enough. The nuclear armed powers telling us, yes, 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 one day we will disarm, but you stay where you are and don't acquire nuclear weapons. We said, no, we want to ban this weapon because it's a threat to humanity. We were just damn lucky that we're still here. A little accident, and there were, we had a couple of close calls, could have devastating effects to the degree that with multiple nuclear explosions, we would have a nuclear winter and the end of a civilization. So next to climate change, this is, in my opinion, the second biggest threat for whole of humanity. So we have this treaty, and now we're working for enough ratification for the entry into force. And in the meantime, we're working on two other issues on the disarmament field. One is what we call explosive weapons in populated areas. As you have followed the conflicts worldwide, you would have noticed they take place mainly in urban settings with non-state actors and with a heavy toll on civilian population. 90 to 95% of victims these days are civilians. And we need to get this number down, spare civilians from armed conflict. And we actually had very good results in with our partners in Afghanistan, where both NATO and the Afghan security forces, by changing their approach to military actions, could cut down drastically the number of civilians. So that's the idea we're having in this area. And the newest front has to do with artificial intelligence, where the big powers are now working on what is called lethal autonomous weapon systems, which is know them under maybe killer robots. So that we are really afraid that we will have, in the end of the day, machines deciding to kill human beings without a human being in control of it. And this is a nightmare from my point of view, that humans are no longer in control of weapons and making the decision to kill another person, but suddenly machines do that. And this is something where we're going to be very active in the future. I'm getting too long and too detailed. International law, as I said, very important to us. So we are pushing to have a lot of conventions where we, as an international community, can agree upon in various fields. Therefore, also for us, the Paris Climate Agreement is so important because it's the framework where we at least have a chance to reverse global warming. And we have seen that even this agreement is not enough. So that's the reason why the Secretary General of the United Nations, Guterres, has called for a climate summit now in September to accelerate the change that we need so dearly to decarbonize our economy to make it sustainable. That brings me to the Sustainable Development Goals. I find it amazing, so I will also make an advertisement for this conference. You can be proud that you hosted here in Utah. And I want to also say tell my thanks to UVU and you all that you're so interested in the United Nations, because it's not many universities, this was a selling argument then for me also to come, that deal with these global issues with the UN itself, and that you have many of you going to New York to attend UN sessions or agency, because we need to work collectively. The challenges we have today are not possible to be solved unilaterally. You need partnerships. We need partnership. We're so interconnected in this world, and nobody can and I don't mean it only in the local context, but also in the European context. We cannot build walls and insulate ourselves from the rest of the world. One of the biggest issues in Europe and in my home country, Austria, is also migration, a very sensitive issue, which is also very highly politicized and has repercussions also to the UN. So this is a necessity to work multilaterally, to work with partners and like-minded to change the world to the better. And I'm very happy that Utah Valley University is doing its part, and everybody who is engaged in this, I want to encourage you to continue this work and to create a better world for us all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Bachelor. Let's take probably around 15 minutes questions, if you don't mind. Yes, Professor.
So talking about nuclear issue, what do you think is going to
happen with JCPOA? The JCPOA is intact, even with the American administration withdrawing. We were very encouraged that the Iranians also stuck to the deal, but they will only if they see a certain benefit out of it. So we, the Europeans, we created a special purpose vehicle so that economic interaction with Iran is possible despite U.S. sanctions. For time being, I'm still positive that the JCPOA will hold, and actually it is, as much as they loathe it, in the interest of the US and the Israeli government, because it gives restrictions to the Iranians without whom they would develop very quickly their nuclear arsenal capacity.
So the UN defines youth as 18 to 32, and if I remember correctly, either like your foreign minister or chancellor actually falls within that demographic. So what is the view of youth and youth involvement in politics, international politics, and the like in Austria?
I mean, this case of my chancellor is I think an extraordinary story, but it's just because he's an extraordinarily talented politician. He entered government as a junior minister in the age of 24. He became foreign minister at the age of 27, and prime minister or chancellor, as we say in our country, in the age of 31. Is today the 19th or the 19th? Yeah, he will be received by President Trump tomorrow in Washington, D.C., in the age of 32, as he is now. It shows also the waves he made as a young leader. I think we have still have a far way to go that it is sort of that the youth participation is getting better. We still have a little bit of a, as I call, but less than other countries, a gerontocracy, that old people think the young people should not have their say. But I think it depends very much on your engagement. And the case of my chancellor shows you just have to believe in yourself and go for it. What we tried in participation is that, well, it's 10 years ago already, we introduced, we lowered the voting age to 16. So when you're now turning 16, you can cast a ballot for presidential or parliamentary local elections, we were not sure how it will turn out, but actually had turned out very well because the youth are engaging politically, discussing, and I think naturally with this you would find more and more young people, it started already, being representatives in political arena. Please.
So Brexit's a major event that's happening within the European Union.
Sorry, please?
Brexit,
yeah.
How is Brexit going to affect Austria in particular as they prepare to leave the European Union?
Yeah. I mean, Brexit is one of the worst things which could happen to the European Union. It is part of this era of demagogues and maybe also a little bit of influencing from foreign powers who love to have a weakened European Union. It is bad. It will not be a catastrophe. I think it will be worse for the Brits themselves being outside. But we lose a big chunk of the European Union. One of our three biggest member states are leaving. They are the ones with, I would dare say, the best foreign policy machinery, the Foreign and Commonwealth Office within the European Union, better than the, don't quote me too, always life, than the French or the Germans. They're really, we will lose out, all of us. Economically, it is also a drag for us, less so for Austria. We have less interconnection with the UK than we have with Southeast and Eastern Europe, and especially with our immediate neighbors. Germany is our number one trading partner, and Italy our number three trading partner. And guess who is the number two trading partner of Austria? United States of America. So that shows you how interconnected we are without knowing it. Yeah, please.
I'm working on a research project now regarding Italian nationalism and migration, and it seems like Austria is the major player in management of migration issues in Europe. So considering there is like a nationalist pushback from inside many countries in Europe, how can Austria and Europe in general continue its migrant management, but still maintain state sovereignty?
I mean, Austria is not immune from that phenomenon. After the 2005, as we see it, migration crisis, it also had a political an outfall where the tendency became more anti-migration. Although we're an immigration country since the 1960s, and we depend on certain kind of immigration, now the mood has swung in sort of trying to curtail migration, especially the what we call irregular migration after the year 2015, where it is not controlled but flows in freely. So you had this fallout, this political fallout you have throughout Europe. It's not only Italy. You have it in the Scandinavian countries, to a certain degree also in Germany, although they have not entered government. But you have it in Scandinavian governments, Denmark, Finland. You have also far-right nationalist parties either supporting the government, as you have in Austria. The far-right is part of the government, and it had an effect on migration policy and also the way we deal with it internationally. So we have then, my government has decided to opt out of the UN Migration Compact with, I don't know, 10, 12 countries altogether, the US being the first one. But it has a big decision making. We have to levels of dealing with it. One is a national and the other one is a European level. We have actually abolished the big part of Europe through the Schengen system, all internal border controls. But without having introduced a joint European Union control of its outer borders. And this was one of the big issues with Greece not being able to protect its borders, which are very difficult, and didn't get any support. Now, slowly, there's a beginning of building a border police, if you so like, a joint European one to protect our outside borders, to maintain the abolishment of the borders between nation states of the European Union, because a lot of the European Union depends that we have this free flow of people, goods, but also capital, the four freedoms in our market. Because what we try to do in the European Union is is replicate what you have here in your union of the United States, that you could settle whenever, wherever you want in another state, or you can open a business somewhere else, or your qualifications of university are respected there. It's just with the complications that we are not only states, but we are nation states, which give up our sovereignty for the bigger cause of the European Union. So do you have these two levels where you deal with also migration?
Huh? Any last questions?
Yes. The coming changes in German leadership, especially with the Chancellor Merkel, what do you think would be impact to the European
Union? I mean, I'd be a prophet if I knew. But it reminds me of the Brexit question too. We had three countries defining the European foreign policy. I forgot to tell that when we entered the European Union, there's also something which is an emerging European foreign policy. We have now also a European External Action Service, it's called. It's not called Foreign Ministry, but External Action Service, and a Common Foreign and Security Policy. So and these were the three big powers, the UK, Germany, and France, were very often the drivers of positioning of the entire 28 EU member states. So with the Brits falling out, whether there will be a third country, so there's now Italy and maybe Spain vying to be part of this influencing club. But in general, in the European Union, you always had Paris and Berlin. If they agreed on something, there was a high chance that they could convince the other EU member states of taking on this policy. Not that they have the votes in a qualified majority voting, but they with the good arguments, they were always eager to steer the European Union in a certain direction. We call it often the motor, the engine of the European Union. If any of those countries has instability or a leadership which is weakened by one way or the other, this European motor is stuttering. So in the moment Sarkozy had his problems with the yellow vests, his focus was not towards what's going on in the European Union in the Brussels discussion. Madame Merkel is I think the leader in the European Union currently. She gave up the party leadership, and that means she eventually will drop out. Her successor as party leader has taken up, coming back to migration, a little bit of a different position on migration. I think this is more a reflection of where the mood has swung to. But on the pro-EU stance, nothing has changed. We didn't know whether after Helmut Kohl, Mrs. Merkel could fill his shoes, and there she was, and did it. I'm rather optimistic that we can also in the post-Merkel era have a strong leadership coming from Germany.
How the Trump presidency and administration has affected U.S.-Austrian relationships, if at all, and if so, how?
U.S.-Austrian relationship. I mean, we're tiny. We're not really on the radar so much of the U.S. administration, but. The fact that my chancellor is invited to the White House, I think it's the first time since 14 years, is actually speaking for it that we did get some attention in the administration, which we maybe lacked even under the previous administration. I think where it's more noticeable is in the multilateral area, UN. We find ourselves, as Europeans in general, on very many issues, on other sides. Most notably, it's painful that we lost them as allies in the human rights field. Human rights, because it's actually our values, our common values, which share. And through that, the disengagement a bit from the United States, from the UN and human rights in particular, we open up a vacuum for other countries to fill. And it's also in the UN, you notice now an ascending China. China has become, after the U.S., the second largest financial contributor to the U.N., the regular budget and the peacekeeping budget, both. It gets more and more positions in the U.N., and it shows also that if you leave a vacuum, it will be filled by somebody else, and which may be not sharing the same values you have. And the United Nations is built actually on U.S. Western values. The whole idea was to have an international system which in the end should also serve the United States, and giving that up, I think, is a wrong move. And the other aspect I would say, where Austria is also part, it's the first time in history that I remember that a U.S. president called the European Union or the Europeans foes, which is a bit difficult for us to digest, because we always thought we were friends and allies, and just because we have a trade surplus makes us a foe. And we understand that the European Union is a complicated animal to understand. Even we, being members, we have a hard time dealing with it. But wanting to destroy it is I think the wrong attitude. What the U.S. traditionally always had, they wanted a strong Europe, a strong allied Europe, because what you need, especially in the international arena, is you need partners. Else you could not push forward your own agenda and your own policies. If you're isolated, and in many areas the U.S. has isolated itself in the United Nations, where the European Union votes against them, which should not be the natural state.
Any last questions?
Please. It's difficult to get into the UN. there's certain obligations for the UN to have a good regional representation in its staff. So honestly, for somebody from a Western country, it is not easy to get in. I know because a lot of Austrians turn to me and say, what can I help them to get in? The successful way so far I found is that you go to missions abroad, in difficult places, in hardship places, where you can, through this, get into a mission and then maybe to another mission, and then get hired eventually by the UN itself. But yeah, there are many agencies also, not only the UN Secretariat itself, and a good way also, if you're interested in a special field, is also through via NGOs, and then maybe being known in a certain field, being hired by a specialized agency of the United Nations, and so on.
We would like to present to you an honorary professorship award.
Oh my God!
You just
right.
Signed by your senior academy vice president, Dr. Jeff Holson.
Wow!
And hold on, I do have some of our companies there.
Trevor, you have to call me professor now.
A little token so you can just put on your office as a
all right. Thank you so much.
Of your passing by here by Utah Valley University. So,
thank you.
This is yours.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now,